Hallo und herzlich willkommen mal wieder in der Speakers Corner. Heute sind wir in der Bayern-Kaserne. Wir werden gleich noch ein bisschen was zu dem Raum sagen, aber erst möchte ich euch die Gäste vorstellen. Ich habe nämlich heute einen internationalen Gast aus dem Senegal, Thiad, und die Astra aus München. Wir werden das Interview auf Englisch machen. We will keep the interview in English. Ist okay? Mhm. Also das erste Interview auf der Speakers Corner, das wir in Englisch machen, soweit ich weiß. Vielleicht gab es auch schon andere. Und zwar geht es über den Senegal, Politik der Flüchtlingsströme, bis hier in Bayern zu ja, ganz detaillierten Ausführungen, was die Asylpolitik hier so betrifft. Also Ursprünge der ganzen Flüchtlingskrise, wie man ja auch oft sagt, und den Auswirkungen und vielleicht auch Lösungsansätzen hier in Deutschland. Welcome, Thiad.
Thank you, man.
You just arrived from Senegal, straight from
yes,
the airport.
Yes.
It's not your first time in Munich, right?
No, that's not my first time.
You knew each other before, you met before.
Yeah, we met last year.
So, Astra, you're quite based in Munich into the refugee scene,
yes,
I would call exactly. It that way. Huh? Yeah. So, you've been working together as an activist and as an artist. You're an
Both.
Activist and an artist
yes.
in Senegal. Mm. Would you like to explain to the people your history in Senegal? What have you done
yes.
as an artist and as an
activist?
And maybe also the reason why you're here now.
Yes, so as you say, thank you also for that interview. And I'm very happy to share this stage with Astra and you. So I'm Senegalese. Let's say African who was born in Senegal, actually. And I started doing hip hop in 1996 with my brother called Kilifa in a band called Kergi. And then we are very political band. So politically we are like talking, our topics are most of the time political issues. And then we get arrested when we were teenager, 15 years old in our hometown, Kaolack. And then we are still the only African hip-hop band who was censored. And then on and on and on, 2011, we created a movement with some other journalists, some friends, some lawyers, some doctors, and like some just regular workers in our country, a movement called Yanama. Yanama mean we fed up, we are tired, it's finished, enough is enough. About the former president of Senegal, who was doing a lot of bullshit, so spending our money in nonsense stuff, not in priorities, having his son there, occupying like four position, ministers positions, and then they were like stealing our money. We didn't have like really good life, so then the country needed the youth to come out and organize the protest, organize the gather, organize youth and show them that it's possible to gather, to fight for your right and stuff. And then finally we ended up kicking that former president out. We have the new one, but the same system is perpetuating, is continuing the same system. So nothing really has changed in our country. So we are still in the movement, we are still doing the activism stuff, but in a different way, because this way we think that the country will grow, the country will change only when mentality of the people are changing. And we think that in 2035, working with the students now, working with the high school students or the university students, from now to 2035, they will get mature. We will have what we expect, the new type of Senegalese, because for us, the country will change when we will have like the new type of Senegalese. So we're working on that, you know, having workshop, doing a lot of programs called Dox Ak Sa Gox, Wax Ak Sa Mère, Wax Ak Sa Député. Very important programs with the kids of the country, with the youth of the country, to make them more involved about what's going on in the country, to understand that the country will change not because one man will decide it, because one man will be on the power, but the country will change only we all get together and want to go and move forward. Yeah.
Okay, nice. So that's like the vision, the goal that I would also like later mm-hmm. to explain with you. What's mm-hmm. what's the concrete goal? What's mm-hmm. your vision? Maybe
yeah.
political
yes.
agenda that you have.
Yeah, for sure, for sure.
But now maybe let's start with the past. You said in 2011 there was the revolution.
Yes.
Where you kicked out the former president. Is this connected with the refugee crisis? A kind of a lot of Senegalese people came to Germany.
Yeah.
Was it connected with this event? Or?
In any case, it's connected because people left the country because they didn't have job. They didn't have no future there. That's why they left the country. And then they were seeking for what we call the El Dorado. The El Dorado could be just across the ocean. So. For sure, when you have a president who is not giving you a job, you don't have any perspective, any future on view. So the only way for you to make it happen is to get out of the country by any means necessary.
Is it still going on? I mean, now you said it's a new president, but still...
The same system is perpetuating, and then people are still taking the boats to come to Europe, which is something that I don't like, which is something that I'm against it. Because they're risking their life, and then a lot of people died in the oceans. And then I can say that people are saying how many people died during the First World War and then the Second World War. I think the Atlantic kills more people than the Second World War. So for me, the first criminal in somehow is the Atlantic. But the people who are complices of that is the African presidents and the system in Europe. Europe established a system that they don't want to have Africans, human, but they want to have everything as resources that we have in Africa. They are taking our oil, our petrol, our gas, our whatever, but they don't want to see people. And our presidents in Africa, they are just assholes. They don't want to work. They are cutting deals with the European presidents to take our money, our resources, and all of that. And they don't give job or they don't give good health to the population. People can't study right. No perspective.
That would also be, I guess, we should do some questions more into detail. What exactly is happening, for example, between the European Union and the Senegalese or African governments in exchange?
Yeah.
Or also maybe not only governments, also the companies.
They sign contracts.
Exactly. Something. This would be also a nice long topic. We can talk.
Yes, for sure.
There later, but now maybe with Astra, because you said a lot of people are coming here and it's ongoing. People are coming here. What's the situation? People, maybe from Senegal, maybe from other companies, countries, there's differences between them. But can you explain what do people expect when they come here, and what do they actually come into when they arrive here?
Yes. So let's start. I'm working for the refugees since 2015, when everybody came over here when the big crisis was. So I was thinking I can do something. I started with medical stuff because that's my real job, and we helped, and we brought them to the doctor. We showed hospitals where they go with them to appointments. Then we started to integrate them with school, teach them German. That was how it started, and everybody was very enthusiastic about it because they were thinking, and at that time, that they can work also, because this is the main reason they are coming over here. They want to learn the language for sure, but also they want to work. They want to bring something or learn something, maybe also to go back later and use this. This is also useful for them to learn something over here. So it started that especially the Senegalese, because we have a lot of Senegalese in our camps, that they could start at the beginning. Most of them arrived in our camp in July. We had contracts, they could work. And after a while, the Bavarian law kind of changed the whole law for themselves in a little law just in Bavaria that they're not allowed anymore to work, because Bavaria or the German government called Senegal as a safe country. So they say they have to leave, they can go back, this nothing is danger for them, so they don't really want that they're working here. We have Gambians, we have Mali, we have Nigeria, all these people can work. Also in the asylum process, but also when the asylum is finished, they can still work. But Senegal is out of that. Senegal is the only country in our camp where the people are not allowed to work.
What's the reason for that? Is it also connected maybe to the
to the revolution or the political situation there? What's the reason
for me now, after all this time, I think for sure they have a kind of agreement. I never saw that, but that's the way I think. Also, maybe one day, not right now, because they could, but to send them back. Macky Sall, I think the president of Senegal, is not really interesting in to have them back in his country, because he said, could be other people. I'm not sure if that are my people, because they have no passport here. They don't really show their identity. Mm. They just say, I'm from Senegal, could be Gambians, whatever. So he's not really interesting in that. That's my opinion. I'm not sure about that, but that's the way I think, because whatever they bring out there, the money, what they send back, also what they get from the government at the moment in our camp, I can just talk about our camps, the people get around 330 euros. It's good. They will send 200, 250 back, the rest they have. So that's perfect.
But, so what I see now, what I hear is like the Senegalese president responded to when people were sent back to Senegal, like a lot of Germans would have wanted Germany to respond to say, we're not taking them without passports, mm-hmm. like the, you know, the undocumented people coming in. That's kind of turnaround.
After 3 years, I try to get an idea what they really want or what is the main reason for that. So at the moment, the situation is bad. They cannot work. They are just in the camps. They are not allowed anymore to go to any school. We can do that just with volunteers to give them some time out of thinking, just sleeping and sitting in the camps. But they start for sure now to give them less money, to deport them to the bigger camps, to the new ones, which also the minister here want to try to build everywhere over Europe, called Ankerzentren. So sometimes they deport them to Bamberg, to Manching, then they get no money anymore. Then they just get food on time. And these big camps we are fighting for, also with the Flüchtlingsrat or with other different...
You're fighting against? Or for?
No, we are fighting against that they get deported, that they get just nothing anymore, they just get food, no money. We try to keep them so long as we can in the camps, if it's possible. But for sure, when they are coming to the bigger camps, they leave.
Is it the same with the Afghan people? Because there's also this Afghanistan is now a safe country. That's almost the same situation.
Yeah, we don't really. We have just one Afghan family, so I cannot really talk about that. Mm-hmm. But I think it's kind of the same way. They also get deported in the bigger camps. But then the most I know, which were the Senegalese I know, which came over there, they left after 1, 2, 3 weeks back in. To Italy, Sweden, wherever. And I think this is the main reason what the government wants, because they cannot deport them, because Senegal is not taking them back. They have no passports, so they give them pressure in every kind of way they can, and then they leave, because they have no families here, like maybe other people in the camps with families. You cannot just leave, you stay there, you are stuck. Nigeria,
I think a really big problem is that when you let people into the country, that's not the problem, but if you let people into the country, okay, undocumented, that's another story. If you don't know who it is, where he's from, now it's even problematic to go back to the country because you're not documented. That's one problem maybe. And the other problem also, if you let people into the country and then not give them work permissions.
That's exactly what.
That's a dead end story, kind
of. So can I say something about what you're saying? The worst thing on earth is to put take away the dignity of people. I think they're not in a camp. They are in a containers. We have to say the word. They are in a containers, like 4 meters, the whole circle, 2 meters, 2 meters, without toilet inside, without no TV, no fridge, just a little bed like a prisoners.
And even without hope and perspective.
Without any perspective, and they are eating cold food, like weekly. It has to be bread and tuna. It's going to be bread and tuna Monday, the morning, the noon, the night for a week, and then they switch to another from another week for something else. This is out of dignity of people. So another point that I want to make about what she's saying. They say Senegal is safe. What means safe? What means safe? United States is safe. How many guns are there? People are killing people in the streets. Is that safe there? Safe is not mean that the country is not in a war. Safe mean when the people can have job. That's what means safe. We are not safe in Senegal. Senegal is not a safe country because you can't have a job, you can't go to the hospital right, you can't study right, you don't have no perspective, then it's not safe at all. We need to put the right word on the right situation. Senegal is horrible. The president Macky Sall is horrible. He's cutting deals, he's taking money out of union agreements. We know there is an agreement in between Europe and Senegal and some other countries. We know there is a contract in between Senegal, Nigeria, South Sudan, and Ethiopia. We know that they are building some infrastructure to bring back all the refugees from wherever you are, and then they will select it, who is Senegalese, who is Gambian, who is Malian, from Senegal. Why they open some office for refugees in Senegal, saying that people who are back here, they can come here for advices? Why? If they have no plan to bring people back, why open an office there and send so many billions of the taxes of German people in Senegal waiting for the refugees to come back? I know for sure 100% that there is an agreement, but that's only not the right time now, because we are in 8 months of the elections. Then Macky Sall can't have all these people back, because it's going to be crazy. But I'm sure 100% from next year, after the election, when everything will be finished, they will ask for people to come back to Africa, and then it's going to be the total chaos.
Here's also an election heading.
I know. That's why.
But what would you recommend, or what would be your plan? Because I heard that you said in the best case scenario, people wouldn't even have to leave. Of course, that's the best thing, eh? not to take the risk of, you know, traveling and then not facing all these difficulties here. Mm-hmm. So I think there's different points where you could start. Eh? Mm-hmm. I think we can start here with the people that are here, that they get more dignity and better treatment, maybe a perspective, or once they are sent back, what will happen there? And of course, the root of the problem, what can we do in Senegal or in these countries to not make people leave? And then I think we are in the big topics with, you know, what's the economic and political future? What can we do?
First, what we have to understand is why I am German, I want to go to Senegal, I just book a flight and I go. So why it's not possible, I am Malian, I want to come to Germany, I book my flight and I come. That's the first question that people should ask themselves. So if we solve that problem, we will go ahead. So the problem is, we are on Earth, and Earth belongs to human being. We could be and we should be able to circulate no matter where you're from, to go no matter where you want to be. That's how it should be. Break down all these barriers, all these borders, that which is not even something that you could see. People make these laws, people separate people, because some people like to just have a power on the majority. So that's the first problem for me. But economically, here in Germany, you have lights everywhere in the streets. You have gas. You can fill up your car full of gas and you just go. But you'd never ask yourself, where is coming the petrol? Because we don't have petrol on the ground in Germany. Where the energy that we are spending, I can have my heater in my apartment when it's cold. I can have my AC when it's hot. I can fill up my car of gas full in its cheap price. I can have some mark of cell phones because of there is a coltan coming from Congo, 8 years old, killing themselves, Kalashnikov from Russia, AK-47 from France, tank from US. They kill each other to get that resources out and bring it for the huge company like Apple, like Samsung, to make their business out and get a lot of money while Africans are dying there. So nobody asks themselves that questions. Where I'm coming, where this energy is coming from? It's not solar.
I think really with this topic, it's very complex, and of course, you don't learn that in school, you don't have to.
You will never learn that.
And people are not engaged to think
that's
about
our
it.
Role, to but, teach the world what's
but
going
you
on.
You as an artist, and not only an artist, as an activist who thinks about it a lot, do you have a clear vision, or do you have even a clear analysis of what's going on? Because I think it's really complicated and it's really complex, right?
That's what's happening now. Europe is abusing Africa. The world is abusing Africa. Imagine Africa is a girl. Everybody is raping her. The world is raping Africa. Africa lose all his dignity. We lost all our dignity because of no cooperation, but they are or still exploitation happening in Africa, which is not right. And then if you can see it on in a bigger picture, it's not only the responsibilities of the Europeans. It's also the biggest part of the responsibility is from our own presidents. Because Germany can't go just now like Germany did it with Namibia a while ago. But now Germans, Merkel can't send militaries in Namibia and take Namibia like by force. No, it's not possible. But she has to find a way with the president of Namibia to cut deals. That's what's happening.
And the companies are doing it, I mean.
And then they after the colonization, they are having a new way. It's multinationals established in Africa. You could see in Senegal, for example, all the businesses belong to multinationals from France, from some other companies, from other countries. We don't give people from the continent to have the chance to grow their business. Economically, they kill the local business. The local entrepreneurism is dead because everything is for the foreigners. Everything is for the West. They take resources from the ground and just bring it back to Europe and then make something out of it and send it back to Senegal and sell it more. It doesn't make sense.
And how do you think can we come out of this situation?
The only way to come out of this is to sign legal contract. You want my oil, you pay the right price. Whoever is the people who based in that land, get out some of it. You can't let some companies in.
So it's actually corruption, I guess. That's
what it's all about corruption. It's all about corruption. But you know, there is two corruption. There is a corruption that you can see the hand, and there is corruption that the hand is under the table, which is the worst one. You can't see it, but that's what's going on. It's crazy.
But do you think that, as a Senegal activist, do you think that you can do the change in Senegal? Can you start in Senegal, or does it have to be like a global, or even connected with people from Germany, maybe even high politicians have to do the change, or how can you really achieve the change? Because I think it's multinationals, it's politics, it's... Can you start it from the grassroots movement, like you tried, I think, mm-hmm. with the movement, mm-hmm. and you succeeded, right? Mm-hmm. But I mean, now it's a big, huge, I mean, global topic and connections. Where to start?
If you see what we did in 2011, and now a lot of African countries copy the example of Yanamar. We have Blaise Citoyen in Burkina Faso, they kick Blaise Compaoré after 27 years on the power. We have Sassou Nguesso, we have Lucha, we have Filimbi, we have Touche pas à ma nationalité, we have Gambia has decided, Yahya Jammeh, who was a dictator, he's out and out of office. So Africans, youth of the continent are having like a new vision of the world and new vision of their own countries. So it's going to take time. We have to be patient. But something is going on. But we need the help of the European population, not the politicians, because they don't care. But if the European populations are aware about what's going on in Africa, and then they support us in the way that what people was gathering maybe 3 weeks ago here in Munich against the police law, 10,000 people out. If they gather like that while we are gathering in Senegal, maybe the politician will get that, okay, now the population of the world are connected, they are against this system. I don't know what mean capitalism, liberalism, socialism. No, we don't need a system. We don't need a system. We need just to be humanist. That's what we need. Humanism.
Do you think that the German people, I mean, now you're also in the position where you face the problems. Do you also see solutions, or do you see something like this?
Yes, yes, and I also support Yana Mayet, for example, for Senegal. And what I can try is, or what I do now, is that because of Chad, I met a teacher there. He's also a Yana Mayet member, and we got in touch, and we were trying, what can we do? I'm private here, I'm alone. He's doing his work there, but we were talking, and we saw we want to find a solution for his kids, his school, very poor school in close to Kaolack. So I was thinking, what can I do? I'm private, I don't have much money, but how can I support that the kids in between the age of the kids in the school is 8 to 14. That means everybody who is over that age has already on his mind, I'm going to Europe. That's too late. So we have to start with the young kids. And what we do is showing documentaries about it's better not to leave the country. They see how are the people suffering on the boats. Then I also do donations 2-3 times a year to on Facebook, big other community platforms. Or I ask people directly. I say, if you give me 5 euro, if you give me 10, super.
That's very ground roots support for Africa. But do you think that the movement, because when you connected with the movement that he built up and it was successful, do you think, and you said also other countries are now copying it, would it be also a possibility in Bavaria or Germany to copy this?
Yes, I'm in a kind of way we are supporting them, not like a movement, but we also go on the street with the people here together. We do demonstrations. We tell the people who are just walking there what's going on, how they can support us. If it's not all about money, it's also supporting them to be, like he say, human. We are humans. What can we do together when we go on the street, when we fight against this? It's not about always a big thing. It could be 50 people, it could be like with the police or 30,000 people, but we are all together and we can try. I'm looking for a way, but I have to get more ideas from other people when I talk to them. We have to try that, like he say, the young people stay in the country and build it like kind of new.
In Senegal. And in Germany, because I would also like, because in Germany, you know, the society, I think, is quite split. Mm-hmm. Yeah? There's the people that are supportive and there's the people that want them out. Yeah? So, I mean, I think we need two game plans. Mm-hmm. One thing is the people that are already active and want to change something, we need a plan. How? What can we do? For example, like you did. Yeah? I think we would need the information here. Okay, what works? How can we do? We need an analysis in Germany. What's the what's the structure? What can we do? And the other thing is, how can we, you know, deal with the people that are maybe not in favor of this action? Because it's, I mean, it's a democracy in Germany. The right wing.
No, there is no democracy in Germany.
I'm just saying. I mean, the right wing party is gathering huge numbers. So I mean, there are people in support, and there are a lot of people not in support. How do you deal with it?
Only way is to bring on the table the truth, because they don't know the truth. Like, for example, the new law about the police here in Bavaria. They say because of the terrorism. The terrorism is something that people say if they are fair about it, they are scared about terrorism, and then allow the government to bring any type of law pretending that they are protecting the population, which is not true. Which is a lie. So if we bring on the table the truth, the people will join the fight. But people are ignorant. That's the first thing. Somebody who can hate another human being is an ignorant. Somebody who can't accept another man coming to his country, able to do some kind of job that he can't maybe do, but he will maybe need to support his own self and support his family somewhere else. And that person is not, he say, oh, I don't want this person here. That person is an ignorant. So ignorance is the biggest issue in the world in somehow.
How as an artist and an activist, how do you fight ignorance? Because, for example, what I think as an African nowadays, here you are most likely to be seen as a refugee. Mm-hmm. That's the label. Mm-hmm. With a man with a beard, you're a Muslim,
yes.
Or an Arab, or a terrorist, or whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of categories that people really just put you in, even consciously or unconsciously. Mm-hmm. But how can you change? If that's the first thing, to get more human, to get more into, you know, maybe empathy with the other people, how do you, what's your plan?
So that's what I'm saying, to break the stereotypes. How to break the stereotypes to be the ambassador of who you are and the best ambassador possible. You have a beard, you are Muslim, show the best of Muslim out of it and the people respect you. You are African, you are not a refugee. You are somebody who's traveling the world. I travel the world. I'm not a refugee. Nowhere. I will never base somewhere else than Senegal and Africa, because I'm African. That's where I believe. But I'm able and allowed to go everywhere in the world, and I will feel free. No matter who is not happy to see me in the street, it happened a lot, but I don't care because they're ignorant. So what's the stereotype is? First, people have to think about something. They are not, for example, bad Muslim or good Christian. They are bad person in Muslims. in Islam. When you are a bad person, when you come into Islam, you will be for sure a bad Muslim. When you are a good person, when you come into Islam, you will be a good Muslim. It's about human being. It's not about religion. It's not about the color of the skin. It's not about where you're from. It's about who you are, how you think, what kind of mentality you have, how you was raised in your house. When I see the kids of Astra, they jump on me. They ask me, where, how is Africa? Oh, this is, they are interested in. They want to see the horses. They want to know some more stories. They ask me how the kids there, they are learning, how the kids there, and they say, okay, mama, we want to collect some stuff to send it to kids in Africa. Because she is watch branding them in the house day after day to let them know that they are human and there are some other human, maybe not with the same color of the skin, but we all human, we all have the same needs. Food, bed, sleep, whatever it is, happiness or study, healthcare and stuff like that. That's the first process. The first process have to come out of the houses. But what the houses, what the people in the houses are interested in? They are interested in whatever is finished outside because they want to go to the mall and shop. But when they go to the mall and shop, if you shop, for example, a cell phone, and then behind, on the back of the cell phone, they say, product coming from Rwanda, coming from Congo. You might respect more Rwanda and Congo because you say that this thing that I need is coming from this country, at least. But we have to do better. Our politicians, this cream of politicians that we have in Africa, we have to kick them out of there. The cream of politicians in Europe is the biggest issue. Because now what's happening in Austria, the racist guy, the Nazi are taking over back. They are having more seats. Europe is becoming racist. Trump is in US. So the world will be in a chaos if we don't do shit. My responsibility is to talk about it as rapper, as singer, organizing my concert, releasing album, talking about those topics. Whoever listens to my music can get an information about what's going on in the world in my own perspective. That's my role.
And that's also why you're here now in Europe and in
yes.
Germany, especially why you're connecting with people. So what would be the next concrete steps for you, or how can you, one support you maybe that heard the first time of your movement, or maybe what would be, you know, first steps in Bavaria to change something?
Yes, having shows, workshops, screening films about us, talking about people, panels, discussions, going to the radio, spreading the word out. Whatever I could do, I will do it. Working with you, Wasim, is a pleasure for me because you're here, you know the country, you know what's going on, what you are doing with the kids. If I can even talk 1 minute with those kids and let them know that I'm African, look at me, but I'm not the stereotype that you have, then it's good. Even one person per day, one man or one woman, one kid per day would work, because when you change the mentality of one, you might change 20,000 after, because that person will show a different way of life to some other people who might copy it, that those people will talk about it, and then it's going to spread the word out like that. So the responsibility of each person in this world is to keep this world safe, this world in peace. So whatever happened, you imagine yesterday they... The world was talking about one handshaking in between North Korea and the United States. Who cares? What they signed? Do you know what they signed in the back? No. Who knows what they signed in the back? Two crazy people shaking hands. The world is talking about it. We don't care. Those people are the people who creating the bombs. They are the people who creating all this military stuff. They are the people who are signing all these laws. They are dictator in a different level and in different ways, but they both dictator. They both dictator. And then those dictators catch our attention? No. I prefer to have the attention on Astra, what she's doing, trying to have 500 euro for 6 months, giving all the computers, all the video projector to a school in a border of Kaolack and Gambia to save or to help kids there. We should have our attention on that instead of on two crazy guy signing some new contract of nuclear bomb stuff or new pact to fight against Syria or against Russia or against Iran. We don't care about geopolitics. We don't care about where you're from. We don't care about those political stuff. We are human. We live on this planet. We have the responsibility to make it like in peace, to bring peace inside, to live together, to be in a good way. So this will only be possible if we let understand this type of politician that we have in the world in general, that this is not going to work anymore. Get your ass up. Get out of here. We want to handle our countries different. And this is the solution. But if we let them do whatever they want, they will create all these weapons, and one day they will bomb somewhere. Someone will bomb somewhere because we let them do. We let them do whatever they want. People have to think about twice. People have to think about twice what they are going to this world. The world is going out of food. But every day in Russia, they create 1,000 bombs. The world is going out of water. But every day in the United States, they are creating a new type of bomb that they can create, biologic bomb or whatever it is. It's all about how to get power. It's all about, I am the first, I am the best. But what we could be proud of it, people showing, I am the best in love. I am the best in sharing. I am the best in giving. When are we going to have a competition, a pre-Nobel of who is the country who is giving the most? There is no pre-Nobel for that. But there is pre-Nobel for asshole, there is pre-Nobel for militaries, there is pre-Nobel of... We need to change the system. We need to erase the system in the computers of the world and then change and create a new world. That's it. I have a friend who say, now that I know the human being, I respect more the animals. Now, me, that I know the human being, how they think, I respect more the animals.
And the beautiful thing is that the human beings also can be very supportive and can be very nice to each other. The question would be, how? And for me, now for you, I think that you have a lot of plans and ongoing actions. Do we have something here in Munich, in Bavaria, maybe to have you a concrete idea or maybe a philosophical idea? Where would you start, or what would you tell the listeners where to start?
For me, what I want to go ahead with is speaking. Is every possibility I get to speak on radio or in interviews, whatever, or I write to the newspapers, articles I already did. I already did in Senegal, just to give an idea about my work. I want to, for me, as a private person, I'm not an artist, I'm not going on stage, but I try everything possible to sensitize the people, to give them an idea. This is a refugee, this is not a refugee, that doesn't matter anyway. Like he say, it's a human. So I talk to people in the S-Bahn, in the U-Bahn, in the metro, wherever the people are, I talk to them. This is the first step, talk. And then you see who is there. And then that's what I mean. We have just to talk to each other. And then we start more. That's how I started. And then I want to know more. Then that's how we met. There was a problem with the Senegalese people here. That's how we met. And then we were thinking, he gave me an idea. That's it. And then he said, but we can do more. And that's what I mean. Out of this, just talking to someone, there can be a huge thing. We did, or I organized two shows for them. They came over here. They were Senegalese, they were Germans. We brought them together. That's the first step. We brought the people together. Senegalese, Gambians, Germans, they had a good evening. We had a good evening. Everybody had a good time. We could forget for 2 hours everything. So they went home and they were thinking. And then maybe they come back to me. They say, Asa, that was a really good show. When are you doing the next? Or what can I do for you? And this is an important question. How can I support you? I need supporters. And that's how it starts. For me, little, private, but that's how I meet people, that's how I talk to people, that's how I met the teacher. Now I support two schools. I can go ahead with that. So my friends say, oh, that's cool, what do you do? What can I do? And I say, I need this, I need that. They give me that. This is just material stuff, but they also support in a way, because they ask me, how is it going on? How are the kids? They send me video, I send them. That's what I mean.
If you have details or contact information, I guess you have a website and stuff, mm-hmm. and we will all put this in the description of the video. So if mm-hmm.
for sure.
if you want to support, and also I think it's important to be active. Every single one has to be active, mm-hmm. and I also think that the abstract fear of the politicians and the refugees and the Muslims, everything that can really vanish once
you talk to each other and start something. Yeah? So I hope that you will have a good...
So that's what I'm saying. The effort that Trump did to shake the hand in North Korea, he could do that same effort to shake the hand of Putin or Iran or whatever. That also could be the reality. And then we need also something very important, alternative media. Honestly, the mainstream media are playing the biggest role in this chaos in this world, because they only show drama. They only show drama. She wrote an article, I brought it to Senegal, but none of the journalists was interested in it because there is no drama in the back. But that was like so important to be like, to prepare the future. Her article just show like the situation now, but show the situation in 20 years maybe, if those law is not changing. But if there is no drama in the back, people are not interested in. So we need alternative media. And alternative media is the media that you are, Wazim, because you are a media. You are an ecosonor. You are like the mirror of the society that you are living. So whoever seeing you can see what's happening in this society. So we have to be our own media. Our own media.
Which the internet is quite a lot of, and music is, is helping.
Exactly.
So yeah, I hope that you will also bring out more music and more.
Yeah, we're gonna have some more concerts in October, November. So we will come back in Germany, and we will come. We will go to Hamburg, and then with some friend behind the camera here. Also, we are setting some other plan. There is another documentary we will release. There is a lot of plans. So if you wanna see us on stage, get ready. This winter we are coming back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Keep me updated.
For sure.
And also, I think that we will also be in touch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For sure. I hope that you find some solutions for the individual situations that you're dealing with.
There are some solutions already, but most of the government people don't even know that. So I go to the government, they call me to explain them, just to finish this, that Senegalese, like the refugees here, can go back to Senegal. Like, going back home and officially coming back over here with a work visa. There are possibilities, but most of the people don't even know that, not even from the government know this way. So there are, I tried to figure out how can I bring them back home in a good way, and how can I bring them back on the legal way. That's a good possibility.
Nice, okay, I will see how maybe we can support each other also with you when you're back here. Sure. It was nice having you, and I hope to see you again.
Come
back.
That was a great moment.
Thank you, Astra. And thank you, listeners. Vielen Dank fürs Zuhören. Ich weiß nicht, ob wir es übersetzen lassen können, aber ich gehe mal davon aus, ihr könnt alle Englisch und habt es genossen. Und schaltet wieder ein, das nächste Mal in der Speakers Corner. Ciao.
Danke.